witness or another person involved in the investigation. B, jeopardize the successful completion of an investigation. Or C, violate local, state, and or federal laws, including but not limited to the right of privacy. Those are the three standards that determine whether it is appropriate to release body worn camera footage. In this case, based on these three standards that I just mentioned, we have determined that it is appropriate to release the body worn camera footage that captured this incident. I'd like to remind everyone that the video evidence is only a portion of the investigation, and we are releasing it for the purposes of transparency, and we release it without drawing any conclusion at this stage of the investigation. All of the info that we are releasing tonight, including the video footage, will be posted on the SFPD website after the conclusion of tonight's meeting. Before I turn the presentation over to Captain Valerie Matthews of a major crimes division, I'd like to explain the investigative process for officer involved shootings. San Francisco has a multi-agency approach or response to officer involved shootings. First, immediately after the officer involved shooting occurs, representatives from the San Francisco Police Department Homicide Unit and Internal Affairs Division, the District Attorney's Office Independent Investigation Bureau, and the Department of Police Accountability are all notified. Then all notified agencies send the appropriate representative to respond to the scene. I'd like to note that the several representatives from those organizations are here tonight in the audience. As far as the investigation goes, there are four investigative processes unless the incident results.
How long we gotta keep putting up with this, man?
Thank you.
How long?
Thank you.
You did Mario Woods, you did that girl, and you did them. How long?
Unless the incident results.
How long, man?
Case 05.
You supposed to be out here doing something, cheap ass.
First, the San Francisco Homicide Detail or Major Crime Detail is the investigative unit responsible for investigating the underlying criminal activity that leads up to the officer-involved shooting, as well as the criminal investigation of the officer-involved shooting. The second process is the SFPD Internal Affairs Division is responsible for conducting an administrative investigation to determine if the involved officers met the standards and requirements of the SFPD policy. The Homicide Unit and Internal Affairs Division run parallel investigations with each has a distinct focus, and each maintains an internal firewall to comply with legal standards and requirements. The third investigative process is the San Francisco District Attorney's Office. Their independent investigation bureau is involved from the onset of the investigation, and based on their independent investigation and review, the district attorney of the city of the county of San Francisco will make the final decision as to whether the officers involved actions comply with the law. The fourth investigative process is the Department of Police Accountability. The DPA is mandated by ballot measure Proposition D to investigate all San Francisco Police Department incidents in which a SFPD officer discharges a weapon involving an injury or death. Lastly, the medical examiner's office has the responsibility of an on-scene investigation as well as collection of evidence from the deceased person, and has a responsibility to conduct an autopsy to determine cause of death and report findings. Now, all those processes are done independently of each other by the agencies that I described. So with that, I'd like to turn this over to Captain Valerie Matthews from our Major Crimes Division, who will now disclose the facts of this incident.
Okay, excuse me, Chief. I have I want to clarify. You indicated that all these representatives are here tonight from the DA's office, from the Office of Public Accountability. I know Captain Matthews is from Homicide Division. And what is the fourth one?
The Department of Police Accountability, the District Attorney's Office, the San Francisco Police Department, both the Homicide Unit and Internal Affairs, and then the Medical Examiner's Office, the coroner. You're not here tonight.
Okay, but the Office of Police Accountability, a representative, is here tonight?
They are.
Okay, who is that person, please?
Sarah Hawkins, Chief of Staff for the Department of Police Accountability.
I'm sorry?
Sarah Hawkins.
And what position are you?
Chief of Staff. And there are also two investigators in
attendance. Who's the director?
Paul Henderson.
Is he here?
He is here.
And then for the DA's office?
Right here.
Okay, can you please stand so I can see you?
Sure, right here.
Okay, and your name?
Anjali Srinivasan. I'm an assistant district attorney. Independent Investigations Bureau.
Angelique?
Anjali.
Okay, and who are you, sir?
Daniel Lundberg, Inspector with the DA's office.
Okay, do you both have cards?
I will gladly give you.
Okay, can I have them, please? Thank you.
Okay, so with that, I'll turn it over to Captain Valerie Matthews for the tactical investigation.
Hi, good evening. I'm Captain Valerie Matthews, and I'm no longer in the homicide unit. I'm over major crimes, and homicide is one of the units that I'm in charge of. In regards to the incident that happened, at approximately 10:30 a.m., dispatch received a call of a robbery and a carjacking at 1800 23rd Street. The information from dispatch and interviews of the victim indicates that the suspect, who was later identified as a 42-year-old Keita O'Neill, grabbed a set of keys from the victim that belonged to a California.
He wants his name pronounced correctly.
Oh, of course, sir. Can you please tell me?
Keontae.
Keontae? Okay, well, I'm so sorry for mispronouncing it. Okay, so the victim that belonged to a California State Lottery van pushed the victim down to the ground, started the van, and drove off with it. The van contained California lottery tickets being delivered to a local business in the area. The victim suffered non-life-threatening injuries during the robbery. The information we received was that there was a second vehicle involved in the robbery, described as a gold SUV with an unknown number of occupants. We believe the vehicle and its occupants were involved in the incident because it was at the scene of the robbery and Mr. O'Neill conversed with the occupants during the robbery. A short time later, dispatch broadcast the description of the van, and it was located by officers on Highway 101 caravanning with the gold SUV. The vehicles exited the freeway, drove off city streets, and marked SFPD units attempted to stop the vehicles in the area of Gilman and Haas. The gold SUV was stopped and the occupants were detained, but the stolen van driven by Mr. O'Neill continued to flee near the intersection of Fitzgerald and Griffith. Mr. O'Neill slowed the van, opened the driver's door, and exited the van. There's a picture being displayed of the area that I'm talking about for you to use as a reference. Mr. O'Neill then began to run towards the direction of the marked SFPD vehicle, while the van he drove continued to roll forward, striking a fence. As Mr. O'Neill was next to the passenger side of the police vehicle, the officer in the passenger seat fired his weapon at Mr. O'Neill from inside the police vehicle. Mr. O'Neill was struck by the gunfire. The officers exited their vehicle, saw Mr. O'Neill was injured. They summoned medical aid and began administering medical aid to Mr. O'Neill while waiting for an ambulance. Mr. O'Neill was transported to San Francisco General Hospital, where he died of his injuries. Now, regarding the investigation into the involvement of the occupants of the gold SUV with Mr. O'Neill and their relationship to the robbery, that's an ongoing investigation that's continuing. At this time, the witness to the shooting is the officer who was driving the police vehicle. He has been interviewed regarding the incident. The involved member has also been interviewed regarding the incident, and they are both cooperating fully with the investigation. We are asking that anyone who may have witnessed the incident or have seen a part of the incident, please contact the police department, as this is an ongoing investigation. Both officers in the vehicle, the witness officer, and the officer that shot were both wearing their body-worn cameras. The witness officer's body-worn camera was not activated. The body-worn camera of the officer that shot was activated and captured the shooting. We have also located video evidence of the shooting from cameras in the area. The evidence indicates that the officer fired one shot from his firearm. We did not locate any weapons at the scene belonging to Mr. O'Neill. Independent Investigations Bureau of the District Attorney's Office, Department of Police Accountability were contacted. They were at the scene and they are conducting their independent investigations. The department's homicide unit is conducting the criminal investigation and the department's internal affairs unit is conducting the administrative investigation. We're not releasing the names of the officers at this time that were involved in this incident as it is a continuing ongoing investigation. We have two videos that we will be showing you tonight. They're very short videos. So with that in mind, we're going to show you each video twice so you'll have an opportunity to view the video and then we'll replay it so you can look at it again. And that's a video from the area. That'll be the first one you see. And then the second video you'll view will be from the officer that fires body-worn camera. And you'll see that video twice as well.
Yes, so Captain Matthews, let me see if I understand this, that both officers in the car were wearing body cameras.
Yes, they were. Okay. So what I'd like to
do. But I just wanted to make sure I got my information correct.
Okay.
And so only one of the officers had the cameras activated?
Yes.
Which officer was that?
That would be the officer that was involved in the shooting.
Okay, thank you.
So what we're going to do is we're going to play the videos. After you have an opportunity to watch both of them, you'll all be given an opportunity to ask questions once you've had an opportunity to review the video and you hear from Captain Ford. So the first video will be from a camera in the area and it's going to show the vehicle that Mr. O'Neill was driving, the carjacked vehicle, which is a white van. And a few feet behind that vehicle, you will see the police officers, and this will be on Fitzgerald coming through the gates of Alice Griffith. So this is on Fitzgerald. There's the white van, and that's the police vehicle in pursuit. They're nearing now the corner of Fitzgerald and Griffin. So that's the first video from the area. You'll see it again. As you see the white van get to the corner of Fitzgerald and Griffin, you'll see that the white van clips a car that's on the corner. And then you'll see the passenger door of the white van open. And at the end of these two videos, later on this evening, these videos will be available on the SFPD website. So if you don't get a clear view and you'd like to review it again, you'll have an opportunity to look at it on the internet. The shooting's already happened and the officers are starting to administer first aid.